Glad to see you all again, and trust that you're benefiting from the reading that you're doing in the Small Church Essentials. Our last meeting is going to be 2 weeks from today, so the 22nd of February. We'll cover the last section and maybe just do some general recap together when we meet. Just to remind you of the format, I'm going to be the talking head for a few minutes here. And then we're going to split you up into breakout groups. Again, Brian's going to do that for us, and it will be random. So you'll get to hopefully interact with some new people. You'll have that breakout time for probably 40 minutes or so. And certainly would encourage you to pray together. So you see that timer show up on your screen. If you get about down to about 3 minutes, maybe either somebody can pray for you as a group, or you want to do quick lift up prayers to the Lord, then certainly you can do that. And then we'll come back and we'll do some sharing, talk about applications for about 20 minutes. And remember that the breakout sessions are not recorded by Zoom, just this and the end session where we're sharing. I hope you're finding value in this experience of working through this and then having an opportunity to talk together about it. I did get word from one church in the Pacific Northwest who is pastor there is leading the session through the Small Church Essentials, and I thought that was pretty cool that they're doing that. Healthy churches are, that's the goal, right? Regardless of size, we want to be aiming at having a healthy church. We've been exploring the principles and ideas together in this book that can set the stage for this section in our discussion, which is how do we bring some new life to our small churches? And again, the goal is not how can we make our churches grow? It is how to bring life to the church. And then because of that, seeing how God is going to grow us, all right? I'm all about the organic nature of Scripture and our relationship with Jesus, that it's because of that that the fruit comes. And so it is with churches. Our relationship with Jesus is really the key to all of this. So we're always trying to be more and more Jesus-centric in our churches, because that's where the life is. You know, the life is not anywhere else but that in the light, in the person of Jesus. Carl, in his book, in this section, quotes Max Dupree, and he says, the first responsibility of leadership is to define reality. Okay, to identify the opportunities, the challenges. If you've done SWOT analysis, you know about all of that. And then what is and what prevents us from being what we hope to be. And really, that's what this section is all about. It's the starting point of how we can do that and help our churches become healthier. So it's about thinking outside the box a little bit. Sometimes we get caught in, well, we are all challenged by, well, we've always done it that way before. But we need to be thinking creatively and outside the box. And to see this process of bringing health to our churches as a process, and not something that we're going to arrive at some predetermined date or a milestone. So it's, we're leading people back to Jesus, our churches back to Jesus and his mission and vision for us in our particular place. The vision that Jesus has for Suzanne's church or Kevin's church is not necessarily the same vision that God has for Bill's or Greg's or Bob. So we need to be on mission, but seeing how the vision plays out for us in our unique places and times. So that's what this section is about. And we're going to be talking together about it. I trust you have your questions handy, because those are the ones that the leaders of the breakout groups are going to be circling around in our time together. And we'll come back together. We'll share some of the things we've learned and how we can, maybe one thing that we can put into practice going forward. So, Brian, with that, if you could lead us into our breakout rooms. So, good to be back together again. Trust that the breakout discussions were good. So let's share together a little bit right now. As you were talking together, what was one thing that really stood out to you? What insight that just kind of resonated with you that you think could make a difference in your thinking going forward?
One of the things that John brought up that was really good, I never thought about it, but he was talking about being strategic compared to being stuck. And he was talking about the Israelites felt stuck in the wilderness, but God has a purpose and strategy, had a purpose and strategy for them. And that the long game is important. And I really appreciated that, John. That was wise counsel. I don't always look at, I look at things like the Israelites do too often. So appreciate that.
Anyone else?
I think our group, we were all taken by the archer parable because, you know, most of us had heard about, you know, the illustration with an archer and it's negative, you know. You shoot and you go draw the diagram, say, look how great a shot I am. And having that applied in a positive way. And really, it makes a lot of sense. What do you do well? And go with it. Mm-hmm. What's God gifting you to? And go with it and build on that. And so I think that was just, it was a surprise element, but also just, yeah, that's right. That's true. And being able to aggressively identify what it is that God's gifting you to do.
Yeah, every church, in my opinion, this is simply my opinion, every church has its own personality and discovering that and leaning in strong into that. So it goes to the whole issue of gifting and what you do well. We don't often think about that. We're trying to, so many of our churches try to implant somebody else's personality. So. What else stood out to you? Don't all
I'll say this because we didn't get to it because the leader was behind schedule again. We need to deduct his pay a little bit. But anyway, the inertia becomes policy thing. I thought that was a great line from the book. You know, that if you reach a point where you allow things to stay in the same position long enough, it's going to get locked in. It will become tradition, whether you intend it to or not. You know, I think it's important to pay attention to that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think the always be changing something is helpful to do as long as you don't go crazy with it. But I liked how always be changing something can simply be, and it's a good way to start, of just asking those evaluating questions after something happens.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you do, everybody, you know, you're not trying to stop anything from happening. So you're not going to get much resistance. You're simply asking the question, you know, okay, this just happened. Let's celebrate what was good. Now, is there something we could do to tweak that better? That introduces change, but not real, you know, real drastic. It can get him used to change and thinking differently. I thought that was really helpful. And if I could just take that and apply that, it would be a very helpful thing to do, you know, because you're not trying to kill something, but can we do it better? That's a good question. I think everybody would like that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Begins to get people in that mindset of moving forward, changing.
We've done Lenten suppers for 45 years here. I've been here 33 of it. We've never stopped and asked the question. Hey, we do this. Wasn't it great? What do we like about it? What could we do better? Hmm. Why not ask that question? We might find some interesting ideas.
Good. Anything particularly changed? We've talked about a few things, but anything particularly changed in your thinking as it relates to your work in the small church that you're in?
I just, you know, mostly what I see, Roy, is just consolidating and clarifying things I've been doing for years and years, and then a reminder to be more intentional about some of those things. You know, we talked about whether you're stuck or strategic, and, you know, in a lot of ways we're beyond stuck. We're selling buildings, you know, and talking about closing churches. So, you know, it's kind of radical, you know, but we've got to get past the ICU as well, as he talked about. And so anyway, I think, you know, what you see in this chapter in particular is a great systematizing of things that are wise. I mean, you know, listening to Matt talk, Matt's been at his church for 32 years. You could see where it's probably not anything new, but it's just nice to have someone put it all on a page, order it, and make it very applicable, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
This could be a good book resource to have the session read it to introduce some of that stuff, because then it's coming from somebody else and they could see how to apply it. And they could even have more ideas than I have about how to apply it. But it really is a good, I really like this book. And I've been reading ahead to the end. I haven't read it all the way through, but there's just some really good, solid things that aren't radical. They're not like, who could do that? It's like anybody could do it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's the beauty of reading a book by a practitioner like you, who's been in the trenches, pastors a small church. This is not somebody who grew his church to 10,000 and trying to tell you how to do it.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah.
Yep.
I think the most encouraging thing for me about the book is being able to tell my very small congregation, this isn't bad. We can be healthy. Don't be discouraged that we're small. Think of what we can do because we're small.
Right.
Perfect.
Yep.
Excellent. Boy, that's worth $1 million there, Greg.
So I think that the way we address some of these things, because we're a small church versus a large church, thinking about them in different ways is very helpful. We talked about the paradigm. You know, whose paradigm is it? And that's where Roy brought the idea about, was it Roy or was it John, about, you know, God is looking at the Israelites in the desert, and he is being intentional. But the other one that struck me was when we do assessments, assessments are usually done by data, by numbers, but it was suggested that maybe what we should be looking at is how are the church members' lifestyles changing by some program or by some event that happens. Have that be the assessment tool, which is very different than how we tend to look at things.
Mm-hmm. Good. All right. Well, we've talked about a lot of these things, and some of these fall into the same category of maybe it being a takeaway. But is there one thing that you will take away from this discussion today, from interacting with the material, that you say, okay, that's something I can actually apply. I'm going to work on that and do that.
It reintroduced me to the idea of the person who does the visitor, you know, the guest visitor who comes in and does an evaluation. I would like to say that will be one thing we're going to get done, but also that evaluation where you look after a program's done of asking those simple questions. And I would like to say I'm going to figure out a way to do that, because I think that would be so helpful. But those two things were the two things that really stood out to me of things I should be doing now.
Okay. Good. Doesn't have to be heavy lifting. One simple thing.
Yeah, and in the same category maybe of not heavy lifting, we're in the midst of a SWOTS analysis in our congregation, and we're small enough, and we've done this frequently enough that I don't think we're going to end up creating some overblown mission statement. But in a smaller church, I think that's far less important. As he says, that's the last thing you should be doing and not the first thing. And I just love the way he, I think his gift is simplifying things. That's common sense in a way, but nobody ever really said it that way before. I feel like that's my reaction often. I just love the way he says this, just say, we do this and this well, and we hope to do this. That's what we want to do. And what a great mission statement, because that's both encouraging, because it's acknowledging how God is actually working in your congregation. And that's very encouraging. But at the same time, without getting overblown in terms of technicalities and everything else, it helps you just say, this is aspirationally where we want to be. This is what we'd like to do. We acknowledge we don't do this well. We need some help. Let's move in that direction.
It's good. Simple is good. Anything else? All right. Boy, for a bunch of church leaders that are used to talking, you guys are really quiet.
If anybody knows how to get a hold of the, you know, finding out who does guest visitor kind of a program, let me know.
Okay.
Yep, that would be good.
Is that called assimilation? Is that under assimilation in some churches? Sort of like the Borg?
Yeah.
I think Church Answers, Tom Rainer, they have something for that kind of evaluation.
Well, and to Greg's point, in all of this, and even as we do this last one in 2 weeks, my hope is that if nothing else, that frame, that mindset, that framework of looking at your church ministries and the life of your body there will change from, gosh, look at how much we lack and we aren't doing things well, to this is who we are and we're not bad. You know, we can be healthy and God can use that. So if that's the only thing that happens out of these four times together, that's a win for all of us. So I hope that comes through loud and clear for you. All right. Well, in 2 weeks, we will reassemble for the last time and we'll look at section four, part four of the book. And then I definitely would love to, I hope at that point to be able to send all of you an email just to get some feedback. We'd love to do something along those lines again going forward. So I'd love to get your input on that, how we could do it better, you know, to Matt's question. In the meantime, blessings to you all. Remember that God's smile is on you. He is working with you and through you and in you for his glory. All right. So blessings to you all, and have a good Lord's Day coming up.